Greetings in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I welcome you to St. Andrew's United Methodist Church. I'm Pastor Witt. Hope you're having a great week. Thank you for the ministries that you're doing in your neighborhood with your family. Thanks for your financial support for the ministries that are going on here. Council on Ministries is kicking up very shortly. We'd love to have some more people coming in and helping us to realign exactly how we're going to be, who and what we are. The garden's getting ready to roll here shortly, and a lot of people have signed up to come and help with that this year. That's absolutely wonderful. Still collecting food for the food pantry. Still asking that if you would carry it over to Ascension, but if you have to, drop it up here and we'll carry it over for you. We're getting ready to do baskets. Easter baskets. You know, 2 years ago we did baskets for Thanksgiving and that was it. We talked about it and said we need to be sure that we help these folks more than just once a year. And so we also did Christmas baskets for the children of our neighborhood school here. And they're getting ready to be out for Easter, and that means that many of these families are not going to have food for the children during that week. And we said, why don't we put together some baskets for them so that they have something to be able to help them during that time. And so we're in the process now of getting ready to do baskets for that Easter week. Obviously, they'll go out before that week. And so if you want to be a part of that, get a hold of the office and they'll set you up with how you can help with that. I determined a long time ago that those who live inside my community, I want to underpin. I want to help other people elsewhere, but those that are real close to me, I want to be sure. And so I've been working with elementary schools for years and years to try and help teach kids to read, to be able to get folks to go in and help out with special needs kids, to be able to feed them, to do book bags and pencils and just all kinds of things, mainly because I don't want people that are in my community to not be underpinned. And with the gas and the food and everything the way it's going up, this is a time for me, and I think for you, to step up in even more real ways. As God leads you, you do it. I think that's about all I wanted to say before we begin our worship. Thanks for coming to worship. Hope you're guided and directed by God, and that you're encouraged in your walk with Christ. Let us begin our worship now by taking a couple moments to center ourselves on Christ. Let us pray. Thank you.
please join me for a call to worship. Ashes have been smeared and sins have been confessed. We follow our faithful Lord. These times, they are troubling. This journey is challenging as we follow our faithful Lord. It is God who sustains, not the temptations of this world, as we follow our faithful Lord. In the Lord is our trust, our protection from harm, as we follow our faithful Lord. Come, let us worship the one whom we serve, as we follow our faithful Lord. Let us center our thoughts and hearts for the worship of God. Jesus, you gather your people to you. You can be gentle with us as a mother with her children. Often you weep over our sins and pride. Tenderly you draw us from hatred and judgment. You comfort us in sorrow and bind up our wounds. In our sickness you nurse us, and with pure milk you feed us. Jesus, by your dying, we are born to new life. We come forth in joy by your anguish and labor. Despair turns to hope through your sweet goodness. Through your gentleness, we find comfort in fear. Your warmth gives life to the dead. Your touch makes sinners righteous. Lord Jesus, in your mercy, heal us. In your love and tenderness, remake us. In your compassion, bring grace and forgiveness. May your love prepare us for the beauty of heaven. Amen.
Before we read the passage this morning, the scripture lesson, I want to give you some bits and pieces to help to give a foundation to this reading. Oftentimes we read a particular passage and it's as though it floats in the air, and I want to give it some grounding this morning for you. Jesus has left the upper Galilee, actually above Galilee, up in the area of Mount Hermon, and moved back down past the Galilee Lake. He is working his way down the eastern side of the lake and then down along the eastern side of the Jordan River, which is more of a creek than a river. But anyway, when he gets down to Jerusalem or to Jericho, he cuts across the Jordan, possibly in a very similar location to where the people crossed across the Jordan when they came up out of Egypt. And he does some absolutely wonderful things inside of Jericho. We're not going to talk about those today, but he passes through Jericho and then uses the old Jericho road. No doubt you'll remember some of the stories, the main one about the guy that's beat up and robbed there and the three folks that either give or do not give him care. But this is the same road, and it's going up from Jericho about 800 feet below sea level to up to Jerusalem about 2,300 or 400 feet above sea level. It's quite a heavy grade. He and his disciples walk this. It twists and it turns, and it's a pretty steep grade. It comes in the southern and works its way along the ridge up to Jerusalem. Now, this ridge passes through the Beths, the houses of Bethlehem, Bethany, Bethphage, the house of bread, Bethlehem, the house of discord or affliction, Bethany, Bethphage, the house of figs, which some places now say that it's the house of unripe figs. Of course, we'll talk about why they say unripe, but it's the house of figs. And then he gets on an animal and he rides this thing the half a mile into Jerusalem. It's from up on top of the Mount of Olives, and there's a road there that actually circles down and around and comes back up on the other side. The Kidron Valley is in the bottom. And then you go into Jerusalem. As Jesus is coming, we're going to talk about this very location again in a few weeks when we get right up to the Holy Week, the Palm Passion Sunday. This is where the palm story happens as Jesus comes over the hill. He's working his way over the hill and down. And at that particular point, all the Gospels end up telling this. They tell it a little different, but halfway down the hill, there's an actual church on the side. Now, as he's coming down the hill, on this side are tombs. They're there today. They were there in Jesus' day. And on this side were olive trees. They were there in Jesus' day. They're there today. The sign of death, the sign of life. He's passing down between them. About halfway down, he bumps into some people, Pharisees. Now, I wanted you to understand who the Pharisees are and what their theological bent is so that you have a better understanding about the conversation that Jesus has with them. The Pharisees believed in what was called the written law, the Pentateuch, the Torah, the first five books, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. They believed in that. So did the Sadducees. Sadducees, Pharisees, two main groups of religious people in Jesus' day. The Pharisees also believed in a thing called the oral tradition. So they believed in the five, plus they believed in the oral tradition, which encompasses much of what you would understand the Old Testament to be today. The Sadducees did not. They were so sad they only believed in these first five. The Pharisees also believed in life after death. And this gives them a particular kind of an interest in Jesus and in Jesus' story after his death and resurrection. The Sadducees do not believe in the oral tradition, nor do they believe in life after death. The Pharisees are more moderate than the Sadducees. I'm not saying that they were progressive, but certainly, you know, one of the things that a lot of us don't really take into consideration when we read the Bible is that there were many different views about God and even inside of Judaism. There were different views, as there are today in Christendom. You have highly conservative and highly progressive people on a continuum on any number of things. And it was the same in Jesus' day. We tend to think about Jews being Jews, but that's not the case at all. They're very different. Right now, we're reading a book by Paige for my Sunday school class. It's called Jesus and the Land. Paige does an excellent job. I disagree with some of his premises. We're discussing that in the class. But he does an excellent job of talking about the different camps that existed and how different towns actually had different theological kind of bents that they had. The last piece that I want to talk about before we read the scripture is this guy called Herod Antipas. He is the son of Herod the Great. Now, if you go back to Jesus' birth, you'll remember Herod wanted to kill Jesus. And so he sent troops down to Bethlehem to kill all the kids 3 years. And, you know, remember that part? Well, this is in the story, the Gospel of Matthew. And this particular one was Herod the Great. His son took over after Herod died. Mary and Joseph and Jesus leave Bethlehem and go down to Egypt. And they wait until they're led by the Spirit to come back. They're pushed by the Spirit down. They're pulled by the Spirit back up. And they plan on going back to Bethlehem because the writer of Bethlehem seems to indicate that that's where they're from. And hearing that the son of Herod is alive and being afraid that they're going to get back into the same mix, they go ahead and move on around and go on up and live in Nazareth. So now you have all the different pieces, and I hope that helps to bring some incredible foundation for what you're about to hear.
Please join me now for our prayer for illumination. As we experience your love and compassion, O God, may we also experience your written and living word. Amen. Our scripture reading for today comes from the book of Luke, chapter 13, verses 31 through 35. Just then, some Pharisees came up and said, "Run for your life! Herod's got your number. He's out to kill you." Jesus said, "Tell that fox that I have no time for him right now. Today and tomorrow, I'm busy clearing out the demons and healing the sick. I'm wrapping things up the third day. Besides, it's not proper for a prophet to come to a bad end outside Jerusalem. Jerusalem, O Jerusalem, killer of prophets, abuser of the messengers of God, how often I've longed to gather your children, gather them like a hen would, her brood safe under her wings. But you refused and turned away, and now it's too late. You won't see me again until the day you say, 'Blessed is he who comes in the name of God.'" The written word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Good morning. This morning's scripture lesson is only a single verse. It's verse 34 from the 13th chapter in the book of Luke. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, you kill the prophets and you throw stones in order to kill those who are sent to you. Many times I've wanted to gather your people together. I have wanted to be like a hen who gathers the chicks under her wings, and you would not let me. This is the written word of God for the children of God. Thanks be to God. Last week, we were reminded that when we begin to pray, that we need to honor God. What did you do this past week to honor God? I'm so very proud of you. I'm hearing stories about you sharing, about you being helpful, about being kind to someone that nobody else wanted to play with. And there was a story about someone being unselfish. All of these honor God. And we were reminded last week that when we pray, we begin by honoring God, and that we have a conversation with God about God. We're not equal to God, and so we must put God first in our lives. God knows what we need before we ask. So we need to have conversations to deepen our relationship with God. We must remember to come to God with respect and honor when we come before God in prayer. Before you pray for anything, Jesus teaches us to talk to God about God, God's holiness, God's kingdom on earth. And by focusing on God, then you're ready to ask for your needs and the needs of others. Today, the prayer bead that we will add is to remind us of the words in the prayer, "Thy kingdom come." Jesus wants us to remember that we need to show others what heaven on earth would look like. And this happens by the way we are every minute of every day. We show others what the world would look like if God's kingdom were to come. God's kingdom come means that every day, all day, we need to act like Jesus. I will do everything I can to show everyone I meet how God's kingdom may look. In today's scripture passage, Jesus demonstrates compassion to Jerusalem. He was compassionate even when people wanted to hurt him. And Jesus was still willing to be kind. How does that help us to understand what the coming kingdom will be like? What can you do to show the world that God's kingdom has come to earth? When I put God first in my life, then God's kingdom will come. Let us pray. God of honor and love, help us to remember to put you first. Remind us to live life with actions that honor you. And when we do that, we will show the world what your creation should look like. God, help us live our lives so that your kingdom may come down to earth. Amen.
Because you've been my friend.
It's a very interesting reading that we have this morning. Inside of this reading, we really run into a couple different things that I find very interesting. This Jesus, if we listen to his, you know, he's being threatened by the Pharisees and by Herod. Now, I want to be clear. I'm not sure whether the Pharisees really wanted to protect Jesus' life or whether they just wanted to make it clear that we don't really want you in Jerusalem. Just turn around and go on back to where you came from, son. I don't know which is true. Maybe both. But Jesus seems to be very centered. He seems to know who it is that he is. He doesn't seem to be in need of others' acknowledgement or love or offering. He seems to have a very centered kindness of who and what he is. The conversations that he has seem to show that out. And in the midst of this, Jesus has come to a place where he has become incredibly saddened that the people did not accept him. Now, I want to talk about these two different ways of ruling, the different methods for ruling of people, of managing people. Jesus tends to take one way, Herod takes another. Jesus, in this way of ruling, seems to want to care for folks, seems to want to, well, the scripture says, you know, how I, old Jerusalem, how I have desired to gather you as a hen gathers her. Have you ever seen this? Have you ever seen a hen gather chicks up under the wings during rainstorms or windstorms or at night? The little chicks will live up underneath there. Jesus seems to have this very, very sad moment where he's come to the conclusion that his ministry is coming to an end, and the days of their gathering up under his wings is not going to take place. Let's take a look for a second at Herod's kind of rule. Now, Herod, without a doubt, learned how to rule from his father, who was a brutal man. Herod the Great was just phenomenally brutal. No doubt you will remember the story that he sent soldiers down to kill all the children from a certain age down. And he went to Bethlehem and did this. And this is brutal. You know, this is dictatorship, where you don't care about other people, where you're oppressive, you're ever-present. The rule of Herod is ever on your neck. A buddy of mine this week called it omnipotent, and I thought, I've never heard anybody talk about a person being omnipotent. And I said, you know, what do you mean by omnipotent, a person being omnipotent? He said, well, he has the rule of life and death. And I thought, well, yeah, okay, wow. Background radiation of everything you do. That was the rule. I began to think about what's going on the other side of the world, and I began to think about what's happening in Russia and there in Ukraine, where some of these towns are being surrounded and are now taken over by Russia. And what we're hearing are, you have to do it our way or you're going to jail, or you're going to be pepper sprayed, you're going to be beat into submission, you're going to be taken off. And the fear for many folks is that those that are taken off will die and never be seen again, or sent to concentration camps where they will be beat into submission. This dictatorial, demanding way of ruling. Herod has this. I am the ruler and you will listen to me. There is no consideration for the will of people. You follow, you pay, you listen, or you die. Now, we have on one hand this kind of rule, which quite frankly a lot of the world ascribes to. And quite frankly, it's one of the reasons that I love America, is that there is at least some freedom in America, that this kind of rule does not exist here in its entirety. On the other side, we have the antithetical kind of rule that Jesus proposes. It's one which offers acceptance of the rule. Now, you may say to me, how is that? Well, very simple. Go back to the garden story and look and see what happens. In the creation, God allows humanity to be in the midst of the creating story, the naming of the animals. And even after the whole thing is put together, humanity is then allowed to exist, to choose whether it follows the rules of God or not the rules of God. And if that weren't enough, God puts his thumb on the scales and balances the scales so that humanity has a true decision. Because only having God as a possible person to hear stuff from is an unbalanced way. God puts his thumb on the scales by allowing the serpent to be there to give another message which balances the scales, and humanity then has a true choice to follow God or to follow self. As we said last week, the serpent, the adversary of God, Satan, offers Jesus some of the same things that he offers the people in the garden. This opportunity to go for self, to be God. The antithetical rule of Jesus is one offering acceptance of the rule, not demanding it, asking for folks to follow, caring for all, loving all, desiring that all follow. Now, I've said this many times, and I mean it in full sincerity, that when I get upstairs, one of the things I'm going to ask God is, why? Why did you give us free will? Why didn't you just tell us what to do? The chaos that exists in the world, I don't know about you, but watching some of these pictures and stuff, that things that are going on, I saw a little six-year-old girl talking with a reporter this past week, and she was talking about, you know, what was going on. The reporter said, what's the hardest thing? And the little girl is fairly together talking, and then all of a sudden the little girl just loses it. And she says, it's horror of night, listening to bombs going off around me. I see elderly people walking that can barely walk or in wheelchairs carrying. As I said last week, the picture of the train station with all the strollers lined up, the parents who had to leave, the mothers who had to leave their strollers and carry their children. And I just thought, my God, from this point forward, the children no longer can be out of the parents' arms, and the parents, there's no reprieve now. They have to carry these kids. The oppression that exists there. God gave us free will. God said, you may choose to be the person that rules, or you may allow me to rule. If you allow me, we're going to have love and grace, and we're going to have a lot of great things. If you choose to rule yourself, we're going to have problems. The chaos that's going to exist is going to be devastating. What is Jesus' way as he heads into the city? What's his goal? It's to offer a new way. It's really to offer the old way. Through the life, the death, the burial, the resurrection of Jesus, the charismatic content of the gospel, Jesus is going to offer a resetting of the scales, a re-initiating of relationship between humanity and God, bringing folks back to wholeness, beginning to remove the chaos that exists in the world. But Jesus, as he came into the world, and as God pushed Jesus into the world to be his agent, the incarnation of God, there is no mandating that this happen. It's free, and folks get to choose. It's freedom. It gives us the freedom to choose or to not choose God. It gives us the freedom to choose or not choose Jesus as Lord, to choose grace or not choose grace, to choose order or not choose order. The message of God touches all of us, and we get a choice. In talking with somebody this past week, they said, well, are there people that do not get to receive this message? And I said, no, there are not. I believe in the prevenient grace of God. John Wesley talked about prevenient justification, sanctification, the prevenient grace of God. The grace of God that brings us the message of God's love prior to our even understanding that there is a God, prior to our understanding that there is. It was the understanding of that when I was a young kid that caused me to be beguiled by this thing that we call grace, so much that it caused me to run towards the church. To be forgiven of what I've done and to be offered love in a way that I'd never received it before was something that I had to have a part of. I had to be a part of. Jesus came into the world and he offered these things to us, and I believe that God has offered these to all people of the world. Even if they have not heard it articulated, they have seen. I believe that nature offers this grace, that we can find this grace of God in nature. We may not know the name of it, but it's there. I believe that the prevenient grace of God is out there working prior to our even having the vernacular to be able to discuss it. And so as I look at Jesus coming over the hill and going into Jerusalem and hearing folks saying, get away from here, get away from here, go for yourself, protect yourself, hide yourself. And Jesus saying, you know, it's this that I came here for. Oh, Jerusalem, oh, Jerusalem. Oh, world, world. How I've desired to gather you as a hen gathers the chicks under her wings. God's been desiring to do this since the beginning. But you who've rejected it over and over and over. He doesn't say it, but it could be said. This week, I'll go into Jerusalem. I'll show you what love is. And as they kill me, I'll look into their eyes and say, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. I'll preach sermons to them. I'll share the grace all the way up until the last second. And then I'll come back and show you how wonderful it's going to be. God be with you this week as you think about how much God loves you. Jesus wants to gather you under his wings. Will you walk under, or will you simply stand in the rain, cold and shivering, and saying, I want to do it my way? It's certainly your choice. I, for one, want to try to get under the wing, because God steps, and we then respond. God steps, and we respond. Amen? Let us pray. Help us, Lord Jesus, this week to contemplate your stepping towards us, your love and care of us. Help us. Help us to respond by loving you back. Help us to nestle up under your wings and feel the warmth of your love. Help us to call others to join us there. In your holy name we pray. Christ our Lord invites to his table all those who love him, all who earnestly repent of their sins, and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sins before God and before one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole hearts. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We've rebelled against your love. We've not loved our neighbors, and we've not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray silently for our sins. Amen. Hear the good news, the gospel. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. Let us pray a blessing on the tithes and offerings and sacrifices that have come in through the mail, through the internet, and those that have been driven up and dropped off. Let us pray for those. Join me in prayer. Generous God, we give thanks for all that you have given us. We return from it an offering for the sake of spreading love as the body of Christ. Open us, Lord, to even better ways to steward your creation under our care. Help us to aid you and bring your kingdom to the world. In the name of Christ Jesus, we pray. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. The night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, he raised it, blessed it, broke it, gave it to his disciples and said, take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And after supper, he took a cup, a new cup, an additional cup. He raised it, he gave it to his disciples, and he said, drink from this, all of you. This is the blood of a new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, O Lord, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here, O Lord, and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the whole world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your Holy Church, honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Let us pray as Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Lord God, make this be a means of grace for us, a place where we find the mystery of your presence. And make this be for us more than just a cup. Make this be for us a sign and a symbol of your sacrifice, your gift, and a call for ours. Amen. You may receive. Join me in singing our closing hymn. into the world empowered by the Spirit of God and be people of God who are living into the desires of God, circling up under God's wings, allowing God to protect, hearing the will of God and following it, entering into a stronger relationship. Go and do so in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Blessings.